Haley Shell's family directly blames that website for linking their daughter up with this man who they say then lured her to run away from home.
There are no rules. There are no age limits. A 14-year-old can get put with a 40-year-old.
Created a haven for pedophilia and child sexual abuse.
Was being groomed by a man that she met on a website. That site is called Omegle.
Hey guys, it's Nim. What's up? And welcome back or to my YouTube channel and welcome back to the Deep Dive series. If you are new here and you do not know what the Deep Dive series is, this is basically where I sit down, I do my makeup, and I dive deep into a certain topic or certain topics. And so, for today's deep dive, we're going to be diving deep into the risks of...
Anonymity.
And so, for today's deep dive, we're going to be diving deep into the risks of anonymity online. Cooked. Anonymity, by definition, is a noun, and it is the condition of being anonymous and a lack of outstanding individual or unusual features, and another word would be impersonality. Now, anonymity online allows for individuals to express themselves without revealing their identity. While this can foster open communication and freedom of expression, it also opens the doors to a lot of risks and negative behaviors. Platforms like Omegle, OmiTV, Monkey, or chat roulette promotes anonymous interactions and are the focal points for exploring these risks, which is basically what this deep dive is. I don't even think I said that. Was Omegle, because as we all know, Omegle did, you know, shut down. Omegle was a free online chat platform that paired users randomly via text or video chat. It was launched in 2009 by Leif K. Brooks, and Omegle's tagline was "Talk to strangers." It did not require any registration, and users could just enter the chat anonymously with no ties to their person or their name, their age, nothing like that. There were two main models. You could just chat with strangers, so like messages, or you could use the most popular form of it, which was video calling. Users could also add interests in order to narrow down who they were paired with, so that it was easier to find people with similar interests instead of, you know, not being able to be like, oh, you like Dragon Ball Z? Same girl, you know? Something like that. But as we all know, Omegle was taken down, as it 110% should have been. But there are other platforms with kind of the same like features as adding interests, although like you can specify to country, or you can specify to age, or you can specify, yeah, those are pretty much the only things that I know you can specify to. In regards to Omegle shutting down, though, Leif K. Brooks actually wrote a personalized message detailing why exactly he shut down Omegle as a website. He detailed why he created the website in the first place and why the site was taken down. But even though the site has been taken down, that has not stopped the major platforms that have then either stemmed from it or also started around the same time that he also created Omegle. So no matter the fact that his platform, even though it was, Omegle was such a massive and major platform that everyone used, it has not stopped people from just going to a different one. so for real right now. Omegle as an app is such an appealing thing to watch. Like, literally, the crazy thing about Omegle is you legitimately have the opportunity of being paired with anyone from anywhere all over the world. Like, I don't know if that's better or if that's worse, but I'm so sorry there was a lighting change because the sun was pissing me off. We all know the appeal behind Omegle. One major one, I would say, is the freedom of expression. Users can literally share their thoughts and ideas and their opinions without the fear of judgment from like real life things, or basically just like real life repercussions. They don't have to deal with the judgment of their own social circle, and it's legit just to a stranger, so it's without the risk of being checked by someone or their personal life getting majorly affected by anything that they say because they are talking to a stranger anonymously online. Like, another major appeal which I did mention is the novelty and entertainment that comes behind Omegle. Like, at the end of the day, it is really interesting how Omegle literally can pair you with someone either down the street or in a whole different continent. Like, it is very exciting, and I feel like it's entertaining to talk to different people. Another one, and I feel like this was a major one, especially during 2020 and the COVID-19 outbreak, was definitely the social interaction that you could get from talking on Omegle, because it was literally free social interaction with anybody who was just awake. And platforms like Omegle offer a way for people to combat loneliness and to combat social isolation to a certain extent, of course. Like, apps like Omegle were definitely boosted by a lot of influencers who were using the apps during like the pandemic. Like, yeah, people were using the app for sure, but people were not posting about it. Like, I feel like before, Omegle was a content type where people would use the app for content. It was simply just it was like a hidden gem, like, I guess you could say. Like, it was a corner of the internet for people. Not this. So now let's get into the risks and dangers of Omegle and anonymity online. The major risk of Omegle is the insecurity of privacy and data security online. I feel as though that one of the major things that I know, like, websites consistently talk about how, like, oh, we will not be collecting your data, don't you worry about that, girl, this is just a fun little website for you to connect with people, and 100%, but there definitely is a sense of data tracking, data collection. Even though an app says, okay, we are not going to store your data information, we are not going to store any of the chats that you say, and I'm pretty sure Omegle as a website specifies that. I've never been on the website before, so I don't know, but I'm assuming they say that, like, in the terms and conditions. At the end of the day, Omegle can still be breached by hackers or people who are trying to track information. Next, I would say, is the IP tracking, which also comes back to data collection. Omegle records IP addresses, that is a given, in order to find people's locations, yada yada yada. I've literally seen, I don't know, I feel like we all have, because these videos are the type of videos with like 20 million views, where people will basically go onto Omegle and then post like TikToks or YouTube videos or YouTube shorts or whatever, where they use the IP in order to like make a funny joke, calling someone by their first name, like by their full name, first, middle, last, or talking about what state or country they're in, asking them about the weather, or talking about some like legit their direct address of their home. And obviously, you know, people who are actually good Samaritans of the world don't like reveal it out loud and like will bleep it out. But I still feel as though that's definitely dangerous. And a major thing is the screen recording of conversations without their without people's consent. And it's legitimately illegal in a lot of places. Like, specifically the video chats can be recorded without the other person knowing, or with the person knowing. Like YouTubers posting things without consent, or streamers who live stream the whole entire thing with everything just being completely unfiltered. All personal information can just be dropped because this other person does not know that they are being filmed, live streamed, broadcasted to the whole entire world without their consent. I think a lot of people don't realize that, one, it's illegal in a lot of places to do that, and two, a lot of the people who go on these websites are minors, and unless a minor 100% gives consent, I just feel like it's weird to go and let a minor, like, I know I'm a minor, but I'm legitimately giving consent, I'm making the content myself, do you know what I'm saying? But it's different when it's a minor who has no idea they are being put on the internet. And that brings me into the next topic, which is the exposure to inappropriate content. If you have been on Omegle, if you had ever gone onto the Omegle website, there was a section where you had to confirm or deny whether you were 18 or not. I'm pretty sure. Like, if I recall when I was going to go on the website, I'm pretty sure you had to, but I don't remember, but I legitimately don't remember, but I am pretty sure, I am 98% sure that you had to select whether or not you were 18 or older. I'm pretty sure. So Omegle obviously can, there's a major risk on Omegle that I feel like obviously people know about and people talk about, because Omegle is consistently criticized for the inability to accurately filter out the explicit content and ban users. And that has been the criticism, I feel like, from the beginning of it being put into mainstream media by YouTubers and TikTokers and all of this nonsense. Users, including minors, okay, can be exposed to nudity, sexual behavior, and other very, very inappropriate material. And that is probably the biggest underlying problem with the whole entire site, is the predatory behavior that can come from the fact that platforms like Omegle have zero filter and zero moderators, zero ways in order to ban a user from going back on that site. The whole appeal of Omegle, right, is how anonymous you can be on that website. And that is the biggest danger about that website, is how anonymous you can be. The fact that anyone can be paired with anyone is both, I guess, a blessing and a curse. Omegle has allowed for grown-ass adults to be paired with people who are like 11, because there are people who don't monitor what their children are doing, which honestly I don't feel like it's a bad thing, but with the way that the internet is now, I would just suggest making sure your child is not going on an app like that. Like, that is so dangerous for them, and it can tarnish them forever. Like, but grown-ass adults can be paired with vulnerable minors and just completely expose them to sexual behaviors, where that has legit been, like, things that people have made content out of on Omegle. And as much as that, okay, it raises awareness for how dangerous the website can be, what really are you doing except for monetizing this type of content and then not contacting the police, not doing anything to put a stop to it? You're kind of just making the content and, you know, hoping that it goes viral. It has nothing to do with actually trying to put a stop to it. It's more just people who want to monetize it, and then once they get the check, they are done. It does not matter the true danger that can come from the fact that these predators then, yeah, okay, they get caught in a YouTube video, What respectable 60-year-old businessman is going onto Nico's cold YouTube channel and finding this one person who might work in their facility? Who? Please explain to me who. The people that are seeing his videos are people who are like 15 to 18-year-olds. That is the range, okay? That is the range of the people who are actively going out of their way to watch these YouTube videos. A 60-year-old is going to have politics in their YouTube recommendation that is not going to come up. And who is going to go and send it to him and be like, hey, check out this video? Because he obviously surrounds himself with people who absorb the same information. And his kids are, his kids going to be like, hey, dad, do you work with this person? No. The problem with this type of content is that it goes in one ear, not the other. People see it, they react, they're like, oh my gosh, that is so gross. Bro got out of the frame so quick. Bro left, whatever. But are you contacting the police? Because one YouTube video is not going to stop this person from continuing to go on Omegle. Because they were not banned. They were not... Nothing happened to them. It was just a one and done, okay? Like, whatever. Like, I've been put on a YouTube video, but still I can go onto the site and take advantage of little kids. The whole thing of people raising awareness and catching predators on Omegle is they actually don't. They don't catch them. There's a difference between exposing versus catching someone. If you catch someone, you're stopping them from doing it again. It's like when you catch a bug. There's a difference. When you say that you are exposing someone versus catching someone, it's a very, very different thing. And that is a major point. It's like, I understand people make content. And yeah, they have raised the awareness. It's the same way that you can raise awareness for a bunch of different issues. But if you are not actively trying to help with the issue, it kind of falls flat. Because walk it like you talk it. I feel like that is such a major point that a lot of people kind of just forget. Like, okay, I get it. Yeah, you've raised the awareness, but now do something about it. You legitimately have the platform to be like, guys, here is this. I have found the person who is in this video. His name is Ronald McDonald. And he did this, 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 that. He works here. This is his thingy. Send it to his wife. Send it, like, do that. I don't understand these people that make the video, make the money, let the video stay up. Nothing else. Because at the end of the day, a police officer is not going to go out of their way to watch this video. The next one that I want to talk about is the risk of harassment and bullying, specifically cyberbullying. I feel like cyberbullying is one of the most dangerous forms of bullying because it can legitimately be so silent. When it comes to things like Omegle, sites like that, it becomes very clear that verbal abuse is very prominent on these sites. I have, like, we see it all the time in those videos where people are making heinous comments. Okay. There's no name to the person who did this to you. Like, you can completely get into a heated argument where someone like tears down your character or body shames you or just makes you feel like completely awful, and you can do nothing about it except for skip the person. But they've said that to you, they've made you feel awful, they've verbally abused you, and then just went on their merry way. That is a major risk of these online platforms and how being anonymous on the internet puts a lot of people at risk for something as bad as cyberbullying. And then obviously the trolling aspect of Omegle. I find trolling to be funny when it's funny. Do you know what I'm saying? There's a major difference between trolling that is funny and then trolling that is just disrespectful. Like, there are so many times when people will use racial language or homophobic language in order to specifically to rile someone up, to trigger somebody, or to get someone to get upset. Like, people do it all the time. I see it all the time. And YouTubers will do it too. Like, they will make it like a point to like purposefully misgender someone, or purposefully say like a homophobic slur, or do something in order to troll someone. But at the end of the day, that is a microaggression. If you don't know, educate yourself before you walk around all ignorant, buddy. Okay. I feel like a lot of people also don't realize that Omegle genuinely can have a definite impact on your mental health, because obviously a negative interaction is going to cause that sort of thing. That sort of thing, like harmful content, anything like that, will cause stuff like anxiety, or going as far as causing depression in some people. But also the aspect of getting addicted to something like that and not even realizing that you are addicted to it. That some people don't realize how addicted they are to the risk or the unpredictability of the whole entire thing. People don't realize it because they think, oh no, I'm interacting with people, you know what I'm saying? But being dependent on it, or, you know, like, imagine all the apps got deleted. Some people would legit like go crazy because suddenly they're not doing it every day. They have to go outside and talk to people, and suddenly they come to the realization that it's Omegle has like caused a fear of in them of like interacting with people, especially for people who like live alone, like don't live with their parents or something like that. People start slowly coming to the realization that they have created an addiction that they don't even realize is an addiction. Another risk that can come from Omegle is how the anonymity can basically take away from any legal or ethical like repercussions or any legal or ethical consequences. Oh my god. The whole thing of anonymity is also you are not held accountable for a lot of the actions. Like, yes, okay, like I said, there's a very small percentage of the things that get published on the internet, but there are a lot of things that do not get published, like illegal activities. Like, there have been reports of literal drug sales happening on that website, or scams, which is an obvious thing, or coordination of criminal activities like robberies or something like that can happen because it's so anonymous. Do you know what I'm saying? There's a major gap that I feel like a lot of people don't realize. Like, a lot of people just are not held accountable for their actions on that website because there's no sense of moderation on that website. Like, zero on any of these websites. Like I said, like with apps like Reddit and with apps with apps like Discord, all of these apps, they have moderators. They have people who are constantly checking to make sure that what is happening is what the website guidelines stand for, is appropriate for the consumers. That is consistently happening. Like, yeah, there are people who fall under the radar, but also there are moderators everywhere, and people on there have some sort of ethics. Majority of the people on there at least have a conscience. But when you know that everything you do is fully anonymous, like you don't have to put in your email, you don't have to put in a phone number, you don't have to verify your email, there's no, like, you don't have to do anything, you don't have to register, you just get to go on there and get off. Like, you are not attached, whereas on these other websites you are attached. There's a digital footprint. You have a digital footprint. Your email is there, your name is there, whatever. You have had to give some sort of identification on there. You have a footprint, you have an outline. Whereas on platforms like Omegle, there is no sense of attachment. You get on and you get off. That's it.
Thank you.
platforms like Omegle have implemented a couple of things in order to try and mitigate the risks and to try and, you know, make sure that the platform is safe for people, like parental controls or stuff like that. But that stuff does not work if your child is just lying to your face. Another one is reporting and moderation, where basically Omegle has a place where you can, where it enforces community guidelines, but it's where users report the inappropriate behaviors, not where like there's actual people constantly monitoring. It's where users can. So in as much as that, yeah, okay, that can help in certain cases, it can't help in a case where a child does not know that they've been taken advantage of. Why the fuck? Did you guys see my lamp just flicker? Okay. Users can obviously be like reporting content, but it does not help if a child does not know that they have been taken advantage of, or they have been exploited or violated or groomed in a way that they did not even realize. And then they obviously did not report this person because they didn't know. So I feel like that stuff works, but does it really work? Okay, so in conclusion, like I always do, platforms like Omegle and just being able to be anonymous online is very dangerous. And I feel like if you did not get that from my video, I don't know what else to say, to be honest with you. It is dangerous. It is very dangerous, no matter how responsible you are and how you use it. And like avoiding content like that, it'll still, dangerous content or dangerous people or negative people, you will always be, they're always shoved in your face, like consistently, whether you're like in person or online. I know, like, obviously parents try their best in order to make sure that their children do not consume negative content like that, but it is becoming more apparent how much younger and younger and younger people who have access to the internet are. Like, but there are a lot of children who won't know, who won't tell their parents because they don't know, and it just goes under the radar. You can become so bold when you know that you are not attached to something, and that is, I think, the best way. Okay, and here's me being like 110% honest, because yeah, okay, like it's nice because you don't have to sign up for anything. But if you legitimately just have someone, like, say, puts in their phone number or puts in their, like, email. So I think, make me president, I think you should make people put some form of information out there that attaches them to it and gives them a digital footprint. Because then it's easier to track down these people. But thank you guys so much for watching this video. I really hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did, please make sure to like, subscribe down below, turn on the post notifications so that you get notified every time I post a new video. And I'll see you guys all next time. Bye, besties! We'll be right back.